news, because one thing I was always clear from years ago already is that electrical ZEV vehicles will be always more expensive than combustion engine vehicles. Combustion engines is the most efficient way to transport goods from A to B, but they emit CO2. And if you want to get rid of the CO2, it gets more expensive.
Well, Martin,
pretty easy equation.
At the same time, I mean, you take a look at the Europe, you take a look at the U.S., and you're really seeing EV demand for passenger vehicles fall off a cliff. You've had to see a lot of automakers really scale back their production plans. And we're talking about commercial vehicles, of course, different kettle of fish. But do those struggles give you any concerns about these plans?
No, because I like your expression, different kettle of fish. It's interesting. You buy a truck to move goods. You buy a truck to earn money with it. You never buy a truck out of fun, and you never buy a truck to impress your neighbor. And therefore, it's a pretty easy equation. If it's more efficient to move goods from A to B with an electric truck, then everyone buys one. If it's not, nobody would buy one. And everything else is then, so the price of CO2 is very important, and any type of regulation by the regulators.
Thanks for joining us once again. Our focus today is on the Tesla Semi creating all kinds of chaos in Europe prior to its arrival. So we're segmenting the show into two sections, kind of the changes created by the Semi, and then the follow-on of how the competition has shifted to address the competitive threat. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Thanks once again for joining us. If this is your first time, welcome. If you're a repeat visitor, welcome back. We also want to thank our Patreon supporters. If you enjoy the show and would like better ideas on investing and trading, please join us on Patreon. So I wanted to open today's show with a quote from the CEO of what is now Daimler-Benz Cars rather than Daimler Trucks. As you may or may not know, the truck and car division have been separated. Now, we have about five general points that we wanted to cover today on this relative to the impact that the Tesla Semi is having. So the CEO of Daimler, now we call it Daimler Cars, indicated that the reorganization was carried out with an eye to taking on the different technological challenges faced by the two companies as the auto sector moves away from combustion engines. So basically, a year and a half ago, Daimler Truck separated from Daimler Cars. Now, what he just shared kind of makes sense, but there's a problem that's been occurring that we didn't understand, but we now understand better. So what that is that there's kind of a, loggerheads going on between two sides of the house. The largest and most important industry in probably Europe, but definitely Germany, is automobiles. They represent 50% of the GDP of the entire country. As you probably know, for every combustion vehicle produced, the multiplier effect is 7 jobs. That's the case here in the United States. And based on the nature of the parts and the vehicles being produced, it will be the same thing in Germany as well. So it's an extremely important sector. Because of the impact of electric vehicles, for example, VW has just chosen to shift production, close and cut 100,000 more jobs and shift production to lower cost production spots around the globe. And Tesla is an important part of this battle. Obviously, the Chinese are as well, as they introduce low-cost vehicles. So the first of perhaps five is the fact that, as you'll notice with Tesla, Elon has chosen to keep both the auto side and the truck side together. The reason is that they share a lot of parts, and you could end up with the trucks pulling up to a vehicle service center and getting all the parts it needs to operate. And this makes it more efficient relative to how these vehicles get into the market space and the ability of technicians to work on them. The challenge, though, is that Daimler has chosen to split the two. It's my belief that the real reason why they're doing this split is because of the fines that accompany the different companies. So one of the assumptions I had when I started this whole process was I assumed that somehow there'd be a way to make sure that Tesla was unable to complete its factory successfully and be able to produce at scale. And as you know, not only are they producing, but they've actually been expanding the production that's going on near Berlin in Germany. Now, this is a problem because every car sold is a non-German produced vehicle that doesn't enter the marketplace. And that's the same for other places, including Sweden and France and other places where Teslas are selling. What's happening is, just like in the United States, if there aren't enough electric vehicles being sold, then there has the makeup for that is fines. So the former CEO of Daimler indicated that the fines may be unfair because it definitely forces the manufacturers to develop their capabilities in electric vehicles, but it actually may be unfair because there are a lot of technical challenges they need to address, and handing out fines doesn't help that at all. So I have to say I'm very surprised, because for a country, a continent that depends on these auto plants that operate in many cities, both in Germany and outside of Germany, I thought there'd be a lot of leeway given by the EU to allow them to slowly achieve these goals. By splitting off the trucks from the cars, the number of engines that are being produced that pollute more are not attached to the cars. So you're reducing your pollution footprint, therefore reducing the fees that you're going to have to pay the EU for not doing a good job of making the transition to electric vehicles. So the bottom line is that Tesla continues to sell more vehicles in Germany and in the rest of Europe that are now being produced in Germany. And all that production is reducing the job count for domestic manufacturers. So it is kind of bad, but not as bad as where you have the Chinese just shipping whole cars from China and not allowing production to happen locally. So this is the first in what I call the car chaos. So the beauty of this for Tesla is that as the European manufacturers have difficulties rolling out vehicles that consumers want, you now have this problem going on of fines for both the truck divisions and the car divisions being there. And double whammy, horrible, is that Tesla is actually driving, the EU is going to California and spending time with Tesla semi-trucks and defining how they're structuring the rules of the implementations of trucks, partially on what Tesla is able to do. The most notable example of this is that if you look at the EU trucks, you'll notice that I call them the flat front trucks. I'll put a photo in for you to see this as well. It turns out that instead of having a structure where you have a long nose and you have a flat one instead, it allows you to increase the amount of length on the back end of the truck, therefore being able to carry more cargo. Tesla has been allowed to sort of violate this tenet because the structure of the truck actually improves its aerodynamics, and so Tesla has definitely gotten a special waiver to be able to do this. And in order to improve fuel economy, one would expect to see vehicles of a similar structure being done by competing firms. Another example of how Tesla is creating some chaos when it comes to the truck space. The next sort of chaos element here is the battle of the batteries. So One of the most famous quotes in this area, and I'll include it in our show today, is that Martin Daum, who's a CEO of now Daimler Trucks, has indicated that as long as the laws of physics are the same in California as they are in Germany, Daimler Trucks, which controls 40% or 45% of the global market for trucks through Freightliner and other brands around the world, will be able to compete. And so therefore, you know, they are, they're ready to compete, but they're skeptical of the pie in the sky statements that have been made by Elon Musk. Now, as you've seen, the Pepsi fleet is rolling. There was a vehicle fire recently, but in general, those vehicles are working. Perhaps number four in the Tesla semi creating chaos problem is that, as you know, Europe has some mountains, not as tall as the United States, but in some cases, when you combine cold weather with mountainous terrain, as much as half the battery range is being consumed by these semi trucks. So if Tesla has a vehicle capable of 500 miles, that means that we're at 250 miles if we lose 50% of range during the coldest months of the year. In the case of the eActros for Daimler Trucks, their best truck is running at about 300 miles of range. Therefore, if they lose half in the colder months, they have about 150 miles of range they can work with. Now, because of this issue, Daimler has elected to go down the path of working to create a hydrogen solution, which, as you know, is approximately triple the cost of fuel of electric vehicles. So as a result, we have a crazy situation going on right now, which is the Tesla semi has not arrived in Europe yet. But there are a number of factors in the form of fines from the EU, in the form of even operating parameters. Item number five would be that for a regular diesel vehicle, those trucks are not allowed to operate because of the noise and pollution on weekends. And Tesla has already been seeking approval to operate electric semi-trucks on weekends because there is no pollution or noise related that would affect how people are enjoying their non-work time. So these are a few of the examples of how Tesla Semi is creating chaos in Europe right away, and it's making money for Tesla. Because if you think about it, if they're being fined for electric semis, there's not a competing Tesla electric semi available yet. But definitely the car division of Daimler has to pay fines to Tesla based on their lack of achieving certain penetrations of electric vehicles. And those fines are increasing annually. So in 2025, we could actually see Tesla's earnings rise without their sales necessarily rising. And the difficulty the manufacturers are having with their success in the EV space against China, as well as Tesla, is making this a double nightmare for domestic makes all over Europe, but especially in Germany, where we have BMW, Daimler, as well as VW Group. So our goal today was just to revisit where we are in the evolution of the Tesla Semi and it's being implemented. I have to say that I am very surprised where we are in the evolution of the semi. The reason is that there has been progress made by Daimler Trucks in particular. In 2017, when they started, they were getting about 120 miles of range. Now, in 2024, they're now up to 300 miles of range for the top-of-the-line eActros. And that's actually, you know, effectively three times the range is an improved in transition. I will say, though, that as Mr. Daum pointed out, the laws of physics are the same, but the quality of new developments when it comes to technology is obviously not the same, and therefore Tesla is enjoying wide open spaces when it comes to selling as many trucks as they can produce. So we really look forward to the new plant being finished by the beginning of 2026, and we can start rolling out new trucks. Please take time to like and subscribe, just a reminder, and any comments also appreciated. It impacts the number of people that we're able to get news information out to. And I wanted to say Vigates, bonjour to our friends in Europe that are watching our show today. Next, we'd like to move on to our health tips for the week. Just a reminder, as you know, we often reference our usual list of make sure you do your 25 leg lifts a day, at least a 20-minute walk, preferably early part of the day, every day, along with three times a week, two times a week, some kind of weightlifting in order to improve all of your health effects. We also recommend Celtic salt, and it works great. I've tried it. I highly recommend it to you. And we'll also periodically start including snippets from other docs whose information I've been working and trying out to see if it works well, and wanted to have you consider it. Also wanted to remind you that it was suggested that no more than once a week for fried foods, and also try to move off of processed seed oils and focus on olive oil as the oil of choice when it comes to the food that you're eating. Once again, thanks for joining us. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Tschüss, au revoir, la hitro, ho da hafez, drasiche, ni hao ma. In Jamaica, we say enough respect, walk good man. Thanks for joining us. Have a great day, and bye for now.